Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm really glad that we have so many people here, that you're all coming tonight, and that I can see so many young people, because the issues that we want to talk about tonight are really touching the future and are important issues, and it will define your future as well, I guess. So my name is Martina Neuwirth. I'm working at the VIDC, the Vienna Institute for Development for Dialogue and Cooperation on International Finance and International Economics, and I will moderate the discussion tonight. As you can see, unfortunately, Ashish Kothari is not with us tonight. Very unexpectedly, he came to Germany, but then had to go to India immediately yesterday, because his father passed away in the night. So he sends his greetings. He's very sorry that he couldn't come, but I think we all agree that this is really an important reason to go back to India. I'm very sorry for that. But I think, anyway, even if we don't have Ashish here in person, we will have him here in a video, a link that he sent me, and we will hear his main visions and his main ideas. And then we can also talk about Ashish's ideas together with Özlem and me and with you. So I think the discussion will be interesting anyway. So we will start the lecture with Özlem Onaran, who came from London to Vienna. Welcome, Özlem. And she will present her ideas of how to tackle the multiple crises that we are facing today. After the lecture of Özlem, we will show you parts of a video lecture that Ashish Kothari gave in 2013 at the Indian Institute for Human Settlement. And finally, there will be room for discussion where you can comment on what has been said, and also you can ask questions. So a few words on the background of tonight's discussion. So, we are living in very challenging times, I think. We have soaring inequality, the globalized economy of the 21st century, and the conditions that states have created for it have increased inequalities. And I just read that according to Oxfam, the 80 richest people in the world hold more wealth than the poorest half of the world's population, which are 3.5 billion people, so it's 80 to 3.5 billion. So these are the dimensions of the inequality we are facing today. And I think we will explore the role that states have played in that matter a bit later. We will also have, or we are also living in times of an ecological crisis. So scientists warn us against irreversible climate changes and biodiversity losses. And the negative consequences, of course, will affect poor people in so-called developing countries more than people in our countries. The main polluters are still Western industrialized countries, but the emerging countries, their ecological footprint gets bigger and bigger, and we will hear Ashish later on talk about this too. We are also facing a global economic and financial crisis. The global financial and economic crisis has exacerbating inequalities, as I said before, and imbalances, and has weakened the political will also to serve the ecological crisis. So it's really a trap that we're in the moment. And in European countries, the financial base of the middle classes, which is a traditional backbone of the state, is systematically eroded. So not only by budget cuts, but also by job losses. And quite recently, I heard a report about a study saying that in the future, jobs will be created at the very top level, at the high quality level, and at the bottom level, low qualified jobs, but there will be less and less jobs in the middle strata, so to say. So the middle classes will be confronted with job losses as well. And at the same time, we're always told that we have to face up international competition. We have to compete with the Indians, with the Chinese. And if we don't do so, Europe is lagging behind. So we will talk about all these crises today, but we will also talk, before we get depressive, we will also talk about alternatives as well. And as you know, there are already a wide range of ideas and concepts, like the concept of buen vivir, the good life, a concept that has been developed in Latin America, the ideas of a solidarity or a common-based economy, the degrowth initiatives, the happiness indices, etc., etc. So there's a growing interest also in alternatives, and I think this is one of the reasons why you're all here, I hope. and so we will talk about this. So you and also Ashish will present your ideas and your concept and also your analysis. But before you do that, I want to introduce you shortly. So Özlem Onaran is a professor of workforce and economic development policy at the University of Greenwich since 2012. Before, she worked at the University of Westminster, Middlesex University, Vienna University of Economics and Business, the VU, the University of Applied Sciences in Berlin, Istanbul Technical University, University of Massachusetts, and at the beginning of your career, you also worked at the Yapı Kredi Bank. In Istanbul.
Now we don't need credit.
So her research focuses on the interaction of income distribution, demand growth, financial crisis, the effects of the financial crisis on the distribution, the effects of international trade, the gender effects of international trade and economic crisis, the effects of globalization on the welfare states, etc. She published numerous articles in books and journals, such as the Cambridge Journal of Economics, The World Development, Public Choice, or The Economic Inquiry, but lots of others. I also want to introduce Ashish Kothari, although he cannot be here, but he will make a presentation on video, so I want to introduce him also shortly. He is a founder member of the environmental group Kalpavriksh. I hope I pronounce it right. He has taught at the Indian Institute of Public Administration, and he has coordinated India's National Biodiversity Strategy and Action Plan process. He served on Greenpeace International and Greenpeace India boards, but he has also been an activist, and he has been very active with various people's movements. And apart from being an activist, he's also an author, so he has written over 30 books and articles, and one of the last books is a book he has written with Asim Srivastava, which is called Journeying the Earth, The Making of Global India. And a lot of content that is in this book will be presented today too, so I mention it. Currently, he focuses on the radical ecological democracy, and he insists that radical doesn't mean radical in a, don't know, caliphate sense, but radical on the basis, the roots. Radical mean a transformation at the roots. Sorry. So he focuses on radical ecological democracy as an alternative to economic globalization. So, Özlem, I ask you to start with your presentation. Thanks.
Great, many thanks, Martina. Very, very many thanks for the invitation. It's always a pleasure to be back to Vienna and to be with so many young people interested in alternative policies is always very exciting for an economist whose day-to-day job is very much confined trying to communicate to very mainstream fellow economists. This talk was really prepared as a conversation with Ashish, who sadly can't be here with us today, and I was seeing my role to put his perspective from the South into the global context and see how we can approach to that from the perspective of the developed world in terms of thinking of our policies as well as our interventions in the global economy. I'll try to broaden that to involve a bit more the Southern perspective, hopefully his video will really enrich that part of the discussion further. Martina has already simplified my life by talking about multiple crises. This is really where we have to think twice in these days. before the economic crisis, before the Great Recession, we were a lot more aware of the limits to our very fragile planet. Sort of the Great Recession, the financial crisis, and the Great Recession that followed, and then the sovereign debt crisis, euro crisis, sort of postponed our thinking in that direction. But I want to start by emphasizing that we don't just have an economic crisis. We do have an economic crisis, and this is a multiple crisis in its own right. We have still the financial sector with all its fragility, which is a ticking time bomb. We have the debt dimensions of that, and I will have a different take about the debt, but certainly we have a problem of both public and private debt here in the Eurozone, but also in the global economy. In terms of talk about the crisis, one thing that we ignore when we talk about financial crisis and the debt crisis, Eurozone crisis, is the inequality. That's another ticking bomb, both socially and politically. For some parts of our very rich, affluent societies, we are talking about increasing poverty, people trying to make ends meet in their day-to-day life. And we have a problem of worklessness, joblessness, unemployment, particularly when it comes to the young people. So with all these dimensions of economic crisis, however, we are in the medium and longer term, we are really living in the very much the boundaries of another ticking time bomb. That is the ecological crisis, the problem, the deepening problem of climate change. Obviously, we have an energy crisis, and this back in the early 2000s, we were thinking we have a peak oil crisis, but now actually we have the crisis related to energy that we shouldn't be using up all those fossil fuel reserves. We have to find means of leaving them in the soil. And this is sorts of an energy crisis in its own right, because although we could probably, with the technological capabilities we have, find solutions to the energy crisis in terms of shifting towards renewable energy, we are nowhere close to that. So we have an energy crisis. And as we try to solve one of these, we notice that we are hitting the boundaries of another crisis, and that's related to, again, the limited boundaries of our world. And the food crisis that emerges with the way we try to use our natural resources to solve issues of climate change or energy crisis. One thing that is not that much discussed, neither among the people who admit the issues of inequality, dimension of the economic crisis, or the people who are very aware of the ecological dimensions of our multiple crises, is the care crisis. A feminist economist, Ipeki Karajan, was saying, actually, our problem with the ecology in the world is very similar to the care deficit we have. And she was saying, we simply don't care anymore. We don't care anymore about ecology, we don't care about the long term, but we also don't care about the elderly. We don't have enough time to give the care required to children. So there is a care deficit. And it is very much, of course, intermingled with the deterioration in working conditions, the lack of decent jobs that facilitate a balance between work and life. So I want to bring in these different dimensions, looking at it from the economic perspective, inequality perspective, ecological perspective, but also from a gender inequality perspective. And of course, all this is, I think, very much capped with another major crisis, which is the political crisis. And I'm having a feel when I look at, I see very young faces here, this is related to that. A lot of us are having the feel that we don't have enough representation, we don't have outlets. So even if we know that there are solutions to these problems, who are the agency to carry those alternatives forward? How are we going to do that? So there is an issue of political crisis, and that's of course a crisis for the established political movements, political parties, the way we knew how politics was made, isn't anymore appealing to a very large part of the incoming younger generations. Is there a way out of that? Well, I think there is, and it's not rocket science. And I often like to start by saying, well, it's a matter of really pessimism of the mind, meaning being aware that we are at a very critical juncture in terms of where our world is going towards, where our societies are moving towards, and we are running out of our time to move forward. So that's the pessimism of the mind. But optimism of the will, meaning, well, we know the alternatives, we can do that, and it's a matter of political will. I have to say that these are quotations from Gramsci, so it's not my own invention. I really like that quotation from Gramsci, pessimism of the mind, optimism of the will. Now, also, if you look at the long-term history of human development, crises have always been important for change. Even within the realms of the capitalist system, capitalism has always evolved through crises. They have been important turning points for restructuring. But the way so far our societies have restructured themselves in the last 200 years, the solution of one crisis have buried the seeds of another crisis, and we have moved through those long-term phases of crises, followed by some stabilization, then followed by another crisis. And my point is, we are running out of time, particularly because of some very physical limits of our biosphere. So in that sense, we don't anymore have much time to restructure from one crisis to another and wait until the next crisis as the problems aggravate. So we need to move quicker than that. Now, there are three scenarios. We can deal with these multiple crises from the perspective of three scenarios. One is the sort of business as usual scenario. I'll talk about all these in a bit more depth in a minute. The second is sort of a visual alternative of a new Green Deal, doing a bit of business as usual, but in a good sense trying to move towards a new golden age to this new Green Deal, with giving quite a lot of big push role to the state in that. Now, I will talk about the political limits to that alternative, but also the ecological limits within that alternative in 2 minutes. And then the third is what I call a equality-led and sustainable development strategy for a global coordination. And I'll, the third and the second alternatives have a lot in common. The third is bringing in more the ecological limits as a serious limit to growth, or at least how we grow, what grows, as I heard from Martina in one of the previous discussions you have had here at that institute. Let me start with the business as usual. The business as usual response to the Great Recession in particular, but to all these different dimensions of the crisis I have mentioned, has basically is taking the form to make the people pay for the crisis. So basically what Europe is doing in particular is to get out of the economic dimensions of the crisis, the debt crisis, is to cut the spending in public goods, make whatever public spending is remaining financed into an increasing extent, to an even increasing extent, financed by even higher taxes on wages, on labor income. The crisis in many countries has been used as a pretext to marketize certain public services or even outright privatize them. And it has been a period where real incomes of many working people have been falling. They've been stagnant in nominal terms, even with low inflation rates. We're talking about significant losses in real incomes. In quite a few countries in Europe, the US, and some southern countries, situation is It's just stagnant in Austria, I know. It's not as bad as in Great Britain, but this is more like probably from your perspective. It's not even, the situation in Austria isn't even good enough to have a bit of a Schadenfreude feel here, I guess. Obviously, austerity is the norm economic policy that we have now written into our constitutions in Europe, and this is, from my point of view, making actually all the causes of the crisis even worse. It's feeding into chronically low demand. It is feeding into low demand not because of just cuts in public spending, but through the lack of jobs, lack of decent jobs, through stagnant wages, through stagnant incomes. It's leading to it's exacerbating our problems of lack of domestic demand, lack of domestic spending out of wage incomes. And it's, of course, then putting more pressure in terms of decent job creation. So if you read the crisis in its roots as a crisis that has been fueled by inequality in its very origins, inequality leading to a chronic deficiency of demand, chronic problem of realization of the high profitability potentially that could be realized, but it can't be realized because nobody is able to buy the goods that are being produced. We are being dragged towards those origins again in the very solutions that our governments are trying to push for to deal with the crisis. In the part of the world where I'm working now, in Britain, the so-called recovery is completely fueled by higher and higher debt accumulation by the households. In this part of the world, in Austria and Germany, you're exporting your way out of that lack of demand. And of course, there are only so many Germanys and Austrias you can have. So not everyone can export their ways out of that, because not everyone can export. For someone to export, for you to be able to export, India has to be importing, Greece has to be importing. So Greece's crisis is, well, actually Germany's or Austria's crisis as well. Sadly, we are not aware of that. The way we are dealing with this crisis is, of course, fueling the global imbalances that was before the crisis further. Now, we have been relying in this part of the world on some last resort consumers in the US, but also in the developing world. We were relying on China to grow at a higher speed such that we can export our capital goods to China. We were relying on high growth rates in Brazil, in emerging economies. These countries cannot be the consumer of last resort. When we push our wages, our demand down, we are also actually dragging their growth rates down together with us. Now, in terms of the ecological dimensions of the crisis, this business as usual scenario is also offering some seemingly alternatives. Obviously, renewable energy is being seen as a very serious new profitable investment opportunity from firms' perspective. Even some traditional fossil fuel investors are trying to diversify towards these. But what I see there is all these profit motifs are not generating sufficient private investment in renewable energy, sufficient enough to really reverse the path of climate change and to reverse catastrophic dynamic reactions on our very fragile planet. On the other hand of the reaction of this business, as usual, nuclear power, again, in the part of the world where I'm coming from, in Britain, it is one thing which is receiving subsidies. We all know about the risks of that. And of course, the US has been the leader of another so-called alternative, shale gas production. Britain is trying to push in that direction very aggressively. So shale gas production is marketed as an alternative to the ecological crisis. However, we are very aware that actually shale gas production itself is increasing greenhouse gas emissions because of the release of methane in the process of shale gas extraction. And of course, there are important issues related to earthquakes, there are important issues related to the contamination of drinking water. So this business as usual scenario, both in terms of the economics of austerity and inequality, but also in terms of the ecological crisis, is just, deepening the crisis we have. So there is the second voice. This is not the dominant voice. That's the heterodoxy in the policy field, which is advocating a new Green Deal led by state interventions. It has aims that are targeted towards tackling other dimensions of the crisis. I mentioned at least some other dimensions. Certainly talking about public investments or incentives to private investors to generate jobs on the one hand, but also invest in green energy. So basically green jobs agenda is coming from that heresy. They are certainly quite aware of the need to tackle the decent jobs agenda and equality agenda in terms of at least income inequality and decent wages. Obviously, what this this group of people don't sufficiently address is the issue of political conflict and balance of power relations. Certainly, if you want to go for a Green New Deal with a strong state intervention, you need policies to finance those investments. So you will need high taxes. You need a redistributive state. And the state in the meantime, in particular in versions where it's not just only about public investments, but it's about giving incentives to private investors, the state will have to be picking winners and losers. And this can only happen if if the transnational capital has no other choice but to let it happen. This happened in the past, say when the Keynesian policies became the mainstream policies after the Second World War, but it happened only after a prolonged crisis, social revolts in the past, and two big world wars, isn't it? In this point in time where we are standing, for the transnational capital to give way to redistributive policies, big state intervention for a new Green Deal, we would need maybe ecological disaster, resource wars, food wars, and at some point they would need, they would be happy to let a Bonaparte save capitalism from capitalism itself, reference to Keynes here. Or it could happen after a major change in balance of power relations, social actors becoming powerful to depower this very strong transnational capital lobbies. Leaving out now the issue of agency and policy, this is not my strength, I want to come back to one other problem in terms of limits to this new Green Deal agenda. New Green Deal agenda is trying to manage decent jobs, decent wages, full employment, and green investments, renewable energy, through a growth agenda. And they are very clear that we need growth, but growth fueled by green investments in physical infrastructure. There is very little talk there about the limits to growth. Now, what I read from the ecological economics is one very important limit. This is the so-called rebound effects. For those of you who have taken basic economics courses, it's sort of an income effect. When your income increases, say through increased efficiency in renewable energy, say we have now solar panels or wind energy, and this is decreasing energy costs. That would work as if you have more real income. When that happens, you may wish to consume on some other stuff more through this positive income effect. So expenditure in non-energy consumption can go up. Well, this stuff, if I consume more food, more clothes, more trips, this doesn't come free of carbon emissions. It would increase certainly greenhouse gas emissions. So that's the rebound effect. As we increase energy efficiency, as long as we don't fundamentally change the way we live, the way we consume, there will be a certain backlash, and we may not decrease carbon emissions or greenhouse gas emissions to the extent we thought we could through technological change. If you like, this second scenario, this new Green Deal agenda, has too much wishful thinking in technological change and technological efficiency. We can do that through innovation and technological efficiency. What I'm trying to say is there may be limits to how much we can achieve through technological change and efficiency in terms of ecological innovations and inventions. We have to be aware of that. We have to give good allowance for that, because some of the changes that are happening in the ecosystem, in the biosphere, are irreversible, and they have dynamic causation effects. So we have to give long ranges of error margins in how we plan things for the future, taking into account large allowances for potential rebound effects. This is one thing. The other thing that is discussed very little I think also in the ecological policy circles, particularly in the north, is the issue of global climate justice. Now, if we are to converge in terms of our living standards, working standards in the globe to a decent standard that we think to be humane, and that can change from region to region, by no means I'm trying to impose one sort of ideal living, but you are aware of the discussions around, say, living wage. What is a decent wage today, say, in Vienna? A sort of a living income idea. What is it that we think to be decent? Access to decent housing, access to decent transport, education, things for a life with dignity. If we are to do that, we really need still a lot of growth in the South. That growth doesn't have to be based on a high carbon print. In this part of the world, we now have to produce green technology. If only we could transfer the technology to the South, that would make it a lot easier for them to grow on much lower ecological footprint. But nevertheless, we need some good quality growth in that part of the world, in the South. If that will happen, then we need to sort of redistribute our rights to carbon emissions. In this part of the world, then, this may imply that we need to manage with a lot lower growth than we thought was the norm. We usually think in economics, trend growth has to be something like 2%. Well, maybe we don't have the chance to grow at 2% level. I'm using the word low growth just not to impose anything. That could be degrowth, that could be zero growth, it could be just anything lower than 2%. We have to think, we have to do our maths, and we haven't really done that in this part of the world. So we need to leave space for development, and that may mean for us managing with low growth. Well, if this is the case, a lot of this Green New Deal people then say, how are we, however, going to tackle inequality and joblessness, worklessness, if we are not able to grow at our past historical trend rates? Here comes the point that we have to think about redistribution in a much more radical way. If we are to reconcile sustainable development, and I'm using here development not just as a concept that is for the South, I'm using that as a concept that is relevant for Austria or for Britain as well. Development as opposed to growth. And development includes creating life standards with dignity for the whole population. And in this part of the world, my feeling, it's not about creating more wealth. It's about creating the stock of our, restructuring the stock of our wealth, maybe moving towards different sort of technologies, like in renewable energy, moving towards public transport, as opposed to producing more private cars, but it's also redistributing from the top. Well, 80 people in London, we say, this can fill a London bus, and a bus full of people own more than 50% of the world. Well, this means we can really redistribute without hurting anyone. I'll try to then put that into context now in my last 10 minutes. What do I understand from this equality-led and sustainable development strategy for both the South and the North? Here I'm talking about policies of wages and public investment in particular, which we will try to coordinate at a global level. I've tried to write a small policy simulation paper using some econometrics, this is my day job, for the Labour 20, for this year's G20 meeting. Labour 20 is the international trade unions and trade union related think tanks, like the Trade Union Advisory Committee to the OECD, who are coming together during the G20 meetings and trying to feed in alternative policies to the labor ministers' meeting, before the finance ministers' meeting of the G20 countries, before the final G20 summit. Am I having wishful thinking just because the labor unions are giving some attention to that sort of alternative thinking? Yes, I am, because I think they are still an important part of the political agency to move things and to change things. Did the labor ministers pay attention to what we produced for them? They didn't even understand, I have to say, because they haven't been trained by a proper economists, I assume. But we are trying to change the curriculum, and there is a global movement for that, such that we can train our ministers better as well. But this is yet to be seen. Now, with regards to the wage policies, what do I mean by coordinated wage policies? What I mean is, let's stop wage moderation in this part of the world. Is that a problem? Martina was saying, we are told we have to compete with India and China. Can we increase wages here? We can't. How can we then export? Well, this is scientifically wrong. Now, I'm not going to bore you, and I'm running out of time anyway, but we have done really the econometric statistical analysis of that. In this part of the world, I am talking about European Union at large, including Austria. If we were to stop the sort of pressure we are exerting on wages through our labor market policies, through our wage policies, through our European Commission directives, if we could just let wages in Austria, in Germany, in Britain grow in line with the rate of increase in the historical productivity of our countries since the 1980s, by increasing the share of wage income, labor income in national income, our evidence proves, and this is very robust evidence, that we would actually increase our growth rates. The question is maybe what do we do with higher growth, in which direction we grow? That's the rest of my discussion. But increasing wages in this part of the world would not be an obstacle to creating more jobs in Europe. We are, in Europe, along with the US, the leaders of wage moderation. Indeed, China is increasing its wage rates a lot faster than Europe is doing. And if we were to reverse this, what we call wage moderation, suppressing wage growth, making wages grow at rates less than the rate of growth of productivity, which is the thing we have been doing since 1980s, for more than three decades by now, in each and every single European Union member state. If we were to reverse that, our evidence shows that Europe would grow and it will leave space for export-led, smaller, emerging economies, developing economies, like South Africa, China, India, Mexico, Turkey, G20 countries in the South, that was our simulation, they would have a lot more space to increase their wages as well. So if we want to have a sort of labor standards at the global level, such that there is no wage dumping, there is no downward race to the bottom in the global world, such that we can preserve the sort of working conditions our grandmothers, grandmothers and grandfathers have maintained in this part of the world all through the decades after the Second World War, we need to start at home and at least out of area of maneuver for the South to develop on decent wages and decent jobs as well. The numbers, if anybody fancies to have a look at, are in a project report we have prepared for the International Labour Office, the full details of the model I'm talking about. Now, this means if we are to gain the most from such a coordinated, what we call wage-led recovery policy, we should be the policy leaders. We should go to G20 meetings and say, unilaterally, we are having policies that would increase the bargaining power of labor, that would give a stimulus to wages, that would create decent jobs with decent wages. That would leave space for the rest of the world. So we should try to avoid beggar thy neighbor policies. First year at home and the rest of the world actually would follow. It would be in their interest to do so. Now, wage-led recovery, though as good as it sounds, however, has its limits. It's not a magic bullet. It's not a magic bullet to solve all the ills of our multiple crises. It's also not a magic bullet to create sufficient numbers of jobs. The good news is higher wages is not an obstacle to job creation, but the bad news is the number of jobs we need to tackle with, say, the youth unemployment, is a lot higher than what we can create by just good wage policies. So we need another strong policy tool. And here comes for me the role of public investments. Public investments, not just like in this Green New Deal policies in physical infrastructure, but public investments also in what we call social infrastructure. Social infrastructure in terms of tackling also the care crisis. Social infrastructure, I'm calling this infrastructure because it's not just current expenditure if we spend in education, in health, in child care, in nurseries, or in elderly care, in nursing homes. This is infrastructure. It's just social. It's not the same physical infrastructure, like investing in public transport, in housing, or in renewable energy, but it is infrastructure and it's very valuable. So that brings me then to a set of policies. A set of policies that have to be all mobilized. So we can't just rely on one tool. We can't rely on good wage policies, or we can't also rely on just good public investment policies in renewable energy. We have to think about policies that would tackle the multiple nature of crisis, that would target full employment, equality, ecological sustainability, and decent care. Decent care for children, decent care for the elderly. Now, coming back to my point about the issue of sustainability and climate justice, and in the north, the requirement of managing with low growth. We need to think of policies, on the one hand, that would redistribute to tackle inequality crisis, on the other hand, create more and good quality jobs, but do all that with low growth. So I will talk about here three dimensions: public investments in social infrastructure, public investments in green infrastructure, and shorter working hours. How can we manage with low growth, but still achieve higher equality, full employment, and a decent life? I'll start with something that is less discussed in these audiences, that is the public investment in social infrastructure, just because I think you all came to talk more about public investment or dealing with green investments or ecological investments. Let me start with this social infrastructure. Why is that so important? It's not just an agenda to deal with the care deficit. It is an agenda to deal with care deficit, but it is also an agenda to deal with the ecological crisis or the ecological deficit. Jobs that may be generated by higher public spending in social infrastructure, in care, health, education, will be jobs that are very labor intensive. You can create a lot of jobs per 1 euro spent in care. You need a lot of people working very slow, right? You don't want to have your carer to be extremely efficient, moving from one house to the other in 5 minutes. you want those people to have a lot of time. You want actually low productivity and very labor-intensive jobs with a lot of good quality, well-educated nurses working in these jobs. Now, these are the jobs this feminist economist, Epeki Karacan, has called purple jobs. They're purple jobs in the sense that they're dealing with the care deficit. They're purple jobs in the sense that they're taking care of something that is otherwise done without pay via the invisible labor of women in the domestic sphere. So they are purple jobs in the sense that it will deal with our gender inequality in terms of how we deal with care, how we deliver care. However, they are not purple jobs in the sense that they are jobs for only women. They are jobs for both men and women with, of course, decent pay. They are dealing with the care deficit and gender inequality, why they're purple. And Epeki Karacan was saying purple is actually at the same time green. Green because it's creating labor-intensive jobs, creating more jobs per low growth. Now, in terms of the, of course, inequality dimension, I just have to say that since because I'm working in London, in terms of dealing with the pay, what I never understood is why are these jobs undervalued jobs with so bad pay? I never understand why a nursery teacher or a carer, with whom you will leave your mother, is paid less than a banker. I mean, obviously, I want bankers to be paid decent wages as well, but my money is, to me, less valuable than probably my mother. So if I think about it like that, I would need maybe higher wages for nursery teachers or carers in nursing homes. This is just an issue of discussion. Now, the second dimension of managing with low growth, but still achieving decent jobs in this part of the world, as well as in the South, would be more investment in green physical infrastructure. Now, I'd say here public investment, because when I look at the history of capitalism, I have never seen private investor taking the risks in cutting-edge technologies, in new sectors, to the extent it was needed. They always need the public sector to create the ground for them, and once it became an established technology, private entrepreneurs would come in. So if we need to reverse climate change here and now, we would need to act now. And whatever profit incentives you give to the private investors, that won't happen. It's still uncharted territory. The risks are high. Physical investments are irreversible and uncertain. So you need the public sector to step in. Here I'm talking about housing, transport, renewable energy, but also ecological repair and maintenance. There is some damage that we have to try to reverse. And of course, if we want the South to catch up immediately here and now, we need technology transfer. We need that along with dealing with, of course, debt relief and other things. Third dimension, now I'm trying to move very quick. If you want to have more jobs per lower growth, well, we know how to do that. We have been doing that throughout the history of the labor movement. Shorter working hours. Compared to 19th century, we are all working part-time now. If you compare how much you're working today as a full-time worker to the 19th century workers, we are part-timers. Shorter hours, if you manage that by wage compensation, particularly for the people who are working below the median income, it would also decrease inequality. And of course, how you shorten the working hours has to think about the other dimensions of our crisis. So it's of course important to address the work-life balance, daily care responsibilities. So you don't want to give people one more extra day such that they can go away fishing. You want to give maybe one more hour every day such that you can spend more time with the people who need care. So we should start caring for the ecology as well as for each other. And I want to make one point, I think, very clear, and it's a conversation that I would very much like to have with Ashish. Public investment for me is not just something that we need to do to speed up the intervention and then leave things to the private sector. If we need public investment to begin with, we may well keep ownership of that. So for me, there are some industries where leaving things to profit motive, leaving things to marketization, is not delivering the quality quantity of the goods and services we want to produce. There are some key sectors for me where I would need public ownership. This is not just having good regulation. This is in addition to regulation. This is about decommodification of basic needs as well as ecological services. So for me, these key sectors are certainly housing. It's not very controversial in talking about public housing in Vienna. It would be, it's very controversial in Britain. But certainly in energy, in infrastructure, in transport, we need public hands. In pension, we need public ownership. We need our pay-as-you-go pension, public pension systems. We need our public schools, public universities. We need our public hospitals. And we need actually banking to be in public hands. I don't think state alone is something to praise. And I'm not here talking about, when I say public ownership, just state ownership. We know that state enterprises can go corrupt as well, or can invest in ways that we don't think to be socially and ecologically relevant. When I say public ownership, I mean transparent, democratic, and participatory decision mechanisms within these institutions, embedded to a broader participatory and democratic plan. When I talk about participation, I think about the people working in these public enterprises. I need I am thinking of consumers using these services and goods. I need regional representatives. We will always have some conflicting needs about the priorities, so we need to get together, compete these priorities, and come up with some consensuses. And we need all that to be transparent. And I think we know how to do that with the technology, information technology we have achieved as of today. It's a matter of will again. Now, all these things about public investments, how are we going to finance that? Obviously, through redistributive taxes. I'll just say one or two things here. When I say redistributive progressive taxes, I don't just mean taxes on income, but also taxes on wealth. Higher taxes than today on profits as well, and of course taxes on financial transactions. The latter has been very popular. We are talking a lot less about taxes on wealth, obviously. One suggestion could be to have taxation rates linked to median income. So basically, you could think of something like a rate of 70% for income, about 10 times the median income. Now, I don't have the Austrian numbers in my mind, but this would, we would be talking about some 1% on the top of the wage and salaried people paying, say, 70% on the extra income they're earning, about that limit of 10 times median income. Say, if you're making more than £200,000 a year, on that extra income, you could pay 70,000. You can think this is very crazy. Well, actually, Piketty is making similar points, but I'll just remind you of the tax rates we had. Well, in this case, in Britain, US had similar tax rates back in late 70s. This is the British tax rate. It was, in today's prices, on income, £1,000 a year, 83%. Now, back then, this was income of 24,000. If you inflate it with the inflation from 79 to today, it's corresponding to 90,000. Only 1% of the people are earning more than £90,000 a year in Britain. So it's actually not hurting anyone, and it was something we had before. I could extend to wealth tax, to inheritance tax, but I will skip that discussion. Obviously, in this part of the world, in the Eurozone, and particularly the southern Eurozone, how to finance public investment immediately hits to the barriers of our holy cow of public debt. Well, we have to seriously think about unchaining, I think, our public spending from this debt. We have to think about how this debt has been created in Greece, in Spain, well, also maybe in Austria, there are people who are suggesting that a lot of this debt is odious, illegitimate, or even illegal, and they are suggesting a debt audit to open the books and look at the sources of debt. Today, well, the whole election campaign in Greece is being played around a similar debate. Of course, there is the household debt dimension as well. Not as important in Austria, but certainly it's important, not just in Southern Europe, but also in Britain. We need to think about restructuring public debt as well as private debt, to think about a proportionality principle. You can't pay a disproportionate amount to your income. Not disproportionate to your GDP as a state, not disproportionate to your income as a household. I haven't said much about the equality dimension. I have dropped the word wage ledge recovery, but of course wage ledge recovery requires policies to about redistribution as well as predistribution, I mean wage setting in the markets. So we think we have to think about how we can reverse the decline in the bargaining power of labor by re-regulating the labor market, improving the union legislation, increasing the coverage of collective bargaining again, and thinking of minimum wage policies to level the playground. Now, the principle is, again, trying to link real wage growth with historical rates of productivity growth. Last point, maybe more for discussion, it's not my strength, but who is going to do that? Who is the political agency to do that? I certainly see here a combination, a multiplicity of social powers for change, trade unions as part of that, civil society organizations, social movements proved to be a very important part of that. And of course, I don't throw the baby with the bath water away. I don't throw political parties out of the picture. We need to transform these institutions to actors of change in the direction that we desire, and that's, I think, feasible. Thank you very much for your patience, and I look forward to hearing your points about that. Thank you.
Okay, so can you hear me? Can you hear me? Yeah. Thank you very much. I don't want to go much into the debate. We want to start now with the short video of Ashish. But before, I just want, maybe we leave that for the discussion afterwards. I just wanted to mention, because you said there has to be a strong role of the state. We have to increase taxes. Of course, all that touches power structures as well, as you said. And I just stumbled over an interview that Warren Buffett already gave to the New York Times in 2006. And it was exactly about the unfair tax system in the US, where the wealthy people pay much less according to their income than poor people or middle-class people. And the author interviewed Warren Buffett, and Warren Buffett says, yes, although he's a rich guy, I would like to pay more taxes. So he's one of the good guys, so to say, under the billionaires. And then he said, and then the interviewer said, but yes, but I mean, it's about also about power relations. And then he gave the answer, and I thought it was rather remarkable, because it was in 2006, rather before the start of the financial crisis, and he said, well, there's a class warfare, all right, but it's my class, the rich class, that's making war, and we're winning. So I think this is really, there's a grain of truth in it, I think. But maybe we leave that also the power relations, how to change that, also to this discussion, and now we start with Ashish.
I find advertisements are a very good way of understanding today's reality. So this one is, the first one on the left is actually an advertisement from about 25 years back, could well be from today, which is an Indian multinational corporation. And if you, the language there, I don't know if you can read it there, but I'll just quickly read it out to you. It says, all over the world, nature's mighty barriers separate oil, gas, minerals, and water from their destinations. Okay, so first of all, nature is a barrier, not something that we live on. Only a handful of international giants can bridge these gaps. One of them is Indian, Dotsal, ripping through jungles in Indonesia, moving the earth in India, laying pipelines. Now, for many of us, this is a ridiculous imagery, but actually this is currently the model of development that is predominant, right? Maybe this kind of advertisement will not be repeated because ad agencies are getting cleverer, but it's still the, and the, I think the only thing missing here is there should have been a bunch of Adivasis also falling off from this forest. Anyway, so that's from 25 years back. This is this year, 26th of January this year, the Ministry of Rural Development issued this advertisement on Republic Day. They may or may not have meant it, I don't know. But essentially, if you look at it, the dominant image here is of an army jawan. And actually, many parts of India, development, rural or urban, does happen at the barrel of a gun, literally or figuratively. It actually does happen through force, violence, and so on. And we see that with the kind of land conflicts that are taking place all across the country. So development essentially has come to mean violence, whether it's against nature or it's against people or against cultures. And India's development now is doing to some parts of the rest of the world what Britain's development did to us, which is that we are actually becoming a colonizing nation. You can see this happening in Ethiopia, where, in fact, this is an old figure now, about 500,000 hectares of land has been taken up by Indian companies to produce things which are for mostly for export to Europe. And these are lands that are not just lying empty. They are actually lands where pastoralists or farmers or others are actually dependent on them. They get kicked out. And Ethiopia is extremely brutal. So anybody protesting actually disappears, gets imprisoned, or actually gets killed. So this is us as a colonial country more and more. So China, of course, is still ahead of us, but we're also getting there. And so finally, to end this part of the talk, I think it's something that Gandhiji said 6-7 decades back is really coming true. Europe and the US already did strip part of the world bare. We are following in the same footsteps, and with several times more the population, that model of development will simply not sustain the earth. So it's something that we have to seriously, fundamentally question. It's not about doing some amount of tweaking here and there and saying, okay, we'll do green economic growth and stuff like that, or CSR activities in corporations, etc. I'm sorry if anybody here is from a corporation, but those are, you know, trying to basically create facades of green, which don't really help with dealing with the system. We need fundamentally different pathways.
This was the first part of the picture he presented, and then he went on to give alternatives. And I just want to give you a few facts, because she said very rightly that in India, development often means is the same as violence. It's a violent form of development. And if you go into the booklet, you will see that, for example, it is true that because of India's growth, millions have been lifted out of poverty, but still 75% of the Indian population live below the poverty line. And a maximum of 25% of the Indian population is the so-called middle class. So 75% of the Indians are completely left out. This is what Ashish says. Only 6% of the Indian labor force is working in the so-called formal, in the organized sector. The rest works informal, often under extremely exploitative conditions. Many still are dependent on agriculture, and agriculture, of course, depends on the climate. So if the climate changes, then also agriculture changes, also the living condition of the population changes. India has the third largest ecological footprint in the world after US and China, not because the Indians are so rich, but because of the sheer size of the country. And of course, also here you have inequality, because the ecological footprint of the Indian wealthiest Indians, so the top hundredths, is 330 times bigger than the poorest 40% of the Indian people. And even a middle-class person like us, you know, like many of us, who owns a car and has a laptop, consumes more than 17 poor Indians. So, and also India has severe ecological problems. So we have half of the Indian energy comes from coal. They have chronic water shortages, climate change droughts, rapid deforestation, many very critical bad hydropower and mining projects where people are forcibly removed from the land, etc. And apart from this homemade problems, there are also import problems. So India imports also several kinds of toxic wastes, metal wastes, including remains of wars in Africa and West Asia. And then amongst them also unexploded devices. So they don't even have, apart from their own power problems, they also import problems. So this is the kind of scenario that Ashish was talking about when he says development is the same as violence nowadays for many Indians. And now he goes on in his speech, and it's only about 30 minutes, about alternatives.
Yeah, so putting this together into some sort of a broad framework, a very, very broad framework, okay, there's not a blueprint for an alternative India, but it's a very broad framework of what we could think of, the lessons from all these initiatives. If you look at these initiatives, one of the most crucial things here is that they're expressing the fact that they're not satisfied with democracy in the form of voting once in 5 years, but democracy in the form of them being part of decision making for things that are affecting their lives. So direct democracy, we've called it radical democracy, there's many different terms that are used. So that's a very crucial part of the, and it's a very dramatic shift if you look at it. So Medhalekha has a slogan, that village I spoke about, which says, in Bombay and Delhi is our government, in our village, we are the government. Okay, so see the difference here, the representative thing there, but a direct democracy where we're living. And the same could apply to cities. If you look at it, I mean, again, the spirits of the 73rd and 74th, the constitutional amendment was precisely this. In actual practice, very little has happened. But where people are beginning to mobilize themselves, it is beginning to happen. But that this form of direct democracy also needs to be sensitive to issues of equity, social, economic equity, and so on, and ecological sustainability. So putting all that together, called it radical ecological democracy. Don't worry about the name. Any name will do. But essentially, it's the principles that are. Oh, and by the way, nobody believes me on this, but this came up first, and then the acronym came later. But nobody believes me, so I stopped saying it. Okay, now I think the most, and I'm going to end after this soon. To me, the most important thing is not the physical aspects of what these initiatives have done. That is, of course, important. But it's the principles underlying, the values underlying these initiatives. So here's the initial set of what has come up. This is not created in my mind. This is basically what people have been saying. So when you talk to them about, okay, what's underlying what you're doing? Not just the water structure or the waste picking or whatever, but what are the values underlying it? And this is an initial list, and I think it's a very interesting list because in many ways it actually challenges our current dominant worldviews. Let's say this, cooperation, collectivity, and commons. Now, if you look at the current dominant worldview, it's everything is about the individual, the selfish individual, I, me, mine. Whereas these initiatives are saying it cannot work like that. It has to be in collectives and commons. Everything needs to be in commons, including ideas. Intellectual property rights don't make sense. Ideas and knowledge has to be part of the commons. So even, for instance, the whole open software movement and things like that is part of that. Or you take anything else, happiness. What is happiness? Reliance would have us believe that happiness is about having a 50-inch television. If you only have a 40-inch one, that's not happiness enough. Okay, but maybe happiness is really about better social relationships, more opportunities for learning, opportunities to grow as a human being, satisfaction with what one has. There's lots of different things that come into play here. I mean, I can talk on and on about each of these values, but just wanted to put up an initial list for, you know, for discussion and for people to start adding more or challenging them, etc. Now, all of this has been developed much further in the form of four aspects of radical ecological democracy. I'm not going to go into them because of lack of time. We need a different form of politics. I've already talked about radical or direct democracy, but of course, direct democracy can only happen in small scale. The larger the scale you get, you will need some form of delegation or representativeness. How do you then ensure that those representatives are accountable to that grassroots democracy? are issues that have to be dealt with, and there are some interesting examples of where that is happening, both within India and outside. For instance, what's happening in Venezuela right now is really fascinating, some of it. This is a potentially very subversive idea, which again is happening in some parts of the world, where you start saying that political boundaries as they are right now don't make sense. If you want to do planning or decision making which is ecologically sensitive and socially and culturally sensitive, then the boundaries need to be determined on the basis of ecological boundaries and cultural boundaries and not political ones as they are right now. Which means even nation state boundaries as they are right now have to be challenged. It makes no sense whatsoever to have a boundary bang in the middle of the Sundarbans forest between Bangladesh and India, or bang in the middle of the Himalayan slopes between India and Pakistan, or whatever, or Tibet and India. And seriously, we have to start questioning those nation state boundaries also. But it's a very controversial topic, so I'll leave it at that. We need a new economics. Well, if you know anybody who's done economics, you will actually find that one of the basics of economics is that there are no ecological limits. And if you start putting ecological limits, the whole economics theory has to be upturned. And there are people now who are actually trying to evolve a new theoretical economics based on ecological limits and other aspects. It also means that, for instance, the indicators of well-being are no longer about gross domestic product and per capita income and blah, 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 but actually much more meaningful things like, do people really have clean water? Do they have adequate nutritious food? Are they happy? Do they have satisfactory relationships, etc.? It also, then the third pillar of this, of course, is justice, social justice. I don't think I need to talk about this, but we need, of course, far more work on issues of justice amongst genders, caste, classes, etc., etc. Fourth and finally is culture and knowledge, where being able to reconnect with the rest of nature, think of knowledge not just in the domain of the formal universities and so on, but in a much broader sense, and of course then talk about personal and community spiritual opportunities. So there's a whole bunch of this here. And I should say very clearly here that I'm not talking about falling into the trap of dogmatic religious fundamentalism here. So, okay, I'm going to skip all this for lack of time, but basically to say there are lots of false solutions out there. Ecology as a fashion is a false solution. If you look at all the property ads today, it's about growing, you know, waking up to the sounds of nature, blah, 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 while they're of course busy destroying nature. There's lots of market solutions, market-based solutions or techno fixes that are being talked about. We have to beware of them. There's strange bedfellows coming up between communal forces and environmentalists. It's happened in my own experience, and we have to be careful about them, etc. What are the pathways to getting to something like a radical ecological democracy? Lots of stuff, people's resistance. If you know, I think at any given time in India, there is resistance to at least 100 different projects going on. Jharkhand, there are hundreds of MOUs that have been signed, almost none of them have actually got off the ground, partly because of Naxalism, but partly also people's community resistance to it. So that is one of the crucial things, because it provides us also space to develop the proactive alternative answers. Then, of course, all sorts of other things are happening, which are kind of pathways to getting towards that alternative future. I'm going to skip this. I did a paper on this whole Millennium Development Goals review taking place right now. For those interested in that sort of UN system and all, I can send you the paper. But it's just looking at how do you reframe those goals and indicators and all that to bring all these issues in, rather than the conventional goals that have been there. Skip that. Okay, end with a series of questions which can be parts of ongoing discussions. In that ideal future, will big industry be needed? I don't know. People tell me that steel cannot be produced without big industry. Others say, why not? We can do technological R&D and actually have small scale steel production. So, question, I don't have all the answers right now. Is profits going to remain a motivation? I personally don't think it needs to, but you know, people can have different views on this. Will the private sector remain alive? Should it remain alive? Question mark. Will the state eventually wither away? Will all things, functions be happening through communities and collectives, and therefore we don't need a state? I think for a very long time we do need the state, but it has to be a very different form of government than what we have right now, which is more a sort of facilitative guarantor of rights and things like that, rather than the top-down controlling nature it has right now. India has got 250 million people who are in the middle classes. What's the role? What's our role? Facilitators, challenging ourselves and our own lifestyles, facilitating what's happening in the grassroots, you know, thinking up new things. There are many possibilities, but it's a question mark right now. And then, of course, we will need political forces. I don't mean political parties necessarily, but political agents to take this kind of thing forward. We need that larger transformation also. We can't do only with these small scale local initiatives. So what is that agency? What is that? Who's playing that kind of role? This is a bit, despite my nation state thing, this is slightly nationalistic here. It's hard to get it out of my genes. But essentially to say that I think we, you know, the Indian subcontinent, let us say, is in a really great position to be able to develop these alternative pathways because of the long history, the civil society activism, the great amount of thinking and churning and the refusal to bow down to army or state power, at least in India, and so on. I think there's a lot of stuff here which are elements of what could be these alternative pathways. So let me end there, and a couple of websites which has more information and my email.
We already are ahead of time a bit. So just a final comment on that. Ashish talked a lot about political change, who could be the political actors. He talked about the role of democratic India, India as being the biggest democracy in the world, as I understood him. What strikes me, and maybe this is also a question to you, is when you read reports about the problems that China has mm-hmm. at the moment, and China has really a very different political system, they're mm-hmm. quite the same. Mm-hmm. So is it really something that has to do with the political system of a country, or is it the global dynamics that are going on and are driving those countries into the mess mm-hmm. we have today? So I will now give the floor to you.
So first of all, I want to thank you very much for your talk. It was very interesting. And so what I noticed is you talked a lot about growth in any way, especially economic way. And did not mention it, I think, at all in this talk. Mm. So what I thought about for growth, you need something to grow on. So basic natural resources, for example, or working force or whatever it is. So what I see is a kind of a contradiction between constant growth and a way of ecological thinking and ecological way of life. So what I want to ask is, why do we need growth? What is your position on that, especially here in Austria or in Europe? Well, I personally don't see any need for growth because it's well as it is. It's in contrast to other countries, especially the South. So yeah, I would like to know your position on that.
Could you perhaps elaborate a little bit on the global dimension of your ideas? Because one thing is to have high taxes on property, but the other one is that the capital will flee. And who can start this process? Because as an economist, you know, it's all a circular economy, and if it leaks out, if your advantages leak out in other countries, there's a problem.
First of all, thank you for the very enlightening presentation. I'm Pushkal, I'm studying here at the Diplomatic Academy. I'm from India. And I have a question related to Mr. Kothari's presentation. I mean, as a person who has been born and brought up in India, I do agree with certain of his points, but a lot of his points lacks coherence in the sense that I think he didn't consider the facts that India being a very culturally diverse country, so it's really difficult. He mentioned decentralization of power. It's really easy to say, but in action it's so difficult because every province in India, there are 28 provinces, and every province in India, it has a different culture, so it's very difficult to unite and form a single environmental policy. And he mentioned different projects, especially the South Korean project on the, in the province of POSCO, And it's a $12 billion project, and it has been stagnated for 10 years. There has been no development because people have been protesting because of environment, but at the same time, they have been living in poverty because there has been no investment in that province. So don't you think this sort of contradicts it? Because if there is social stagnation, and at the same time, you have economic stagnation, so the socio-economic development of the masses will be stagnated.
Thank you. My question is, if the economists require more information from the ecologists in order to make the decision, so, or do you have sufficient information from the effects of the economy on the environment?
Don't really cut to the core, to the essence, which is that the labor market is changing. The industrializing has decreased the jobs around. What computers are doing now is what happened with the machines as they moved people out of the labor market. Where we see the great growth is now in China, and you try to put it in a certain perspective. But the growth there is happening because there is no infrastructure, there is no machines. And you criticized, for instance, the competition with labor in terms of the price of labor, how these poor countries are competing by driving the labor price down and down and down. But this is actually the only way that they can compete with machines. So what I'm saying is that you try to avoid the main problem, which means that the way that people will work in 50 years is going to be significantly different from what is happening right now. One thing which you mentioned with your purple jobs is of course very right, that the people will move into this one sector where they work with other people, some things that machines can't do. But then again, there's the huge majority of labor force is in a sector that is going to be taken over by machines. If you look at recent developments, such as artificial neural networks, these machines are better than people at recognizing written words or faster and everything. So the whole world is going to change. And what I want to criticize is that economists on these days try to like put this on this side. They have no solutions, no ideas on how to solve this problem.
You kind of left the topic of state-sponsored jobs open for discussion. That's what you said. And I think maybe one of the problems with your very interesting ideas could be that when you're shortening working hours, mm-hmm. and also looking to increase wage or stop wage moderation, also moving a lot of people into the state sector, which is your caring part, right? Are you really sure that, I mean, it's certainly a good start in my opinion with wealth taxation and so on, but are you really sure that the financing only by taxation would be enough for those projects in a big scale, like globally? Because it seems to be require a lot of money to really increase wage overall and decrease working hours at the same time. Thank you.
Thank you very much. These are all very important points. Let me start by repeating myself, just to avoid misunderstanding. I am not talking about growth, but about development and about full employment or decent jobs. That's my agenda, equality, decent jobs. I am emphasizing that in this part of the world, we have to, and we can, manage with low growth. I started by saying, I'm saying low growth, and it's an open question. How low growth should be? Is it zero, or maybe should we degrow, or maybe it is 0.5% growth? This is something we have to figure out. Obviously, as we restructure our economy, some things will grow. If you invest in housing, public transport, renewable energy, in care, that generates growth. We want to also restructure our consumption. We want to change our behaviors and consumption culture, and hopefully these will change the rate of growth as well as the composition of growth. And it may well lead to managing with no growth in this part of the world. I totally agree. I totally agree that our problem here is not generating more wealth, but changing the composition of this wealth, our capital stock, out of fossil fuels towards renewable energy, out of cars towards public transport, towards zero energy houses or even active houses in public ownership, collective ownership. So these are all very consistent with what you said. I can only agree with you. I just want to, however, emphasize, in my talk, growth as a word is repeated a lot, not to endorse it. And as an alternative, I'm trying to carefully use sustainable development for Austria, for Europe, as much as for India, for Global South. And it's not the same thing as sustainable growth. And this is where I am disagreeing with the new Green Deal agenda, which doesn't recognize the limits to growth. It also doesn't recognize the redistributive aspects that I'm talking about. Now, where I am a little bit in disagreement with Ashish when it comes to the role of the state, and this is coming in also some of the questions, and in the last question in particular, how do I see that? I want an active state. This doesn't mean a monstrous dictatorial machine. It's a democratic participatory, but not minimalistic. So I don't see state as facilitator. It's interesting because when I was hearing Ashish, I think of neoliberalism as a project, and it talks about state as just something that guarantees private property rights, isn't it? That's the only role that it envisages for the state. For us, state has to be, I think, more than just a facilitator. It has to be, for me, an investor, but it doesn't have, the investor or active state doesn't mean top-down state. You can have bottom-up state. You can think of the participatory budget experiences in the world. Brazil, managing in large federal states like cities like Porto Alegre, federal states like Rio de Grande with participatory budgets. We can think about that at the national levels and at the global levels as well. Bottom up, active investors. Where should it invest? And that has to be a discussion of democratic discussion. Now, do we have enough information? We have some information, of course. There was a colleague who raised the issue here. We have a lot of uncertainty around that information, so we have to go with the most pessimistic forecasts of the scientists in environmental sciences about the limits and the risks to our planet when we are making economic decisions. Because if we try to go with their midpoint, if we're making a little bit of a mistake there, the implications of that on ecology are irreversible and are too big. So the risks are too big that we can't just go with simple expected probability calculations there. We have to take the most pessimistic estimates very serious and move with that. And we have, of course, some information. The implications of that is not very good news, say, for a very large fossil fuels industry or other vested interests, so that's why we're not making full use of that. Where I really agreed with Ashish was his point about we need an eco-regional, we need an approach that has eco-regional planning in it. And I was listening to a Chinese economist 2 weeks ago, Jun, who has published on food crisis in China or malnutrition crisis in China, when you brought up the China question that immediately came to my mind, in the Journal of Agrarian Change, among other places. What he's saying is the process of marketization in China has caused massive malnutrition in rural China, inequality that manifests in itself in terms of malnutrition. However, he says, if we are to reverse that, if we are to feed these people at, you know, decent levels, the amount of food supply we need is additional food supply we need is equivalent to the current food supply in the world. So this doesn't mean that we can't do that, he goes on, but the question of who is going to feed China, if we are to take that serious, and as human beings all over the world, we have to take that question serious, is a question that requires serious eco-regional planning. Who is going to produce what for whom? And Jun is going even further to the extent that he's saying we need to also think about consumption standards. Not everyone can consume like an American citizen. So obviously, we can't just leave that to this liberal choice idea. There's nothing particularly anti-democratic here, but we have to be aware of the limits to our planet, the issues of equality in the consumption of food. Then this leaves us with a limited planet, with all the innovation we have, even if we can think of massive technological progress, we have a limited planet with limited supply of soil. I was referring to the other issue of dealing with the energy crisis and how that leads to food crisis. The more we use, of course, agricultural land for production of grains, for production of biofuel as opposed to food grains. So there are all these issues at stake. But again, coming back to the information issue, there's research that shows with renewable energy investments in countries like Korea, Indonesia, South Africa, there is so much that can be done in terms of job creation. This is coming from University of Massachusetts. Bob Polin and colleagues have prepared for UNIDO, headquarters in Vienna. This information is out there. This technology is out there, and we are not making full use of that. Their forecasts are showing, actually, that there is so much that can be done, even with the existing stock of technology we have. Now, so let me take from the word technology your point. Are we ignoring technology? I'm all friend of technology, and I, among others, have looked very carefully into the effects of technological change in terms of rising inequality, which is a point that has not been picked up at all, say, in Piketty's discussions. Now, a lot of the mainstream discussion about rising inequality, particularly falling share of labor and rising share of capital in national income, says that it's an unavoidable outcome of technological change. If we are not against technology, well, bad luck. Here is what we have to live with. Labor's share will fall against capital's share. Well, this is wrong. Some econometric evidence, including what a colleague of mine, Evini, some of you might have met before, Engelbert Stockhammer, has very diligently estimated the effect of technological change on increasing inequality and compared that to the effect of welfare state retrenchment, financialization, globalization, change in labor's bargaining power, including change in union legislation that manifests itself in the form of falling union density. Guess what? The effect of technological change is statistically insignificant. It's not robust. And our point is, in that part of political economy approach, if you like, to rising inequality, technological change has been happening since Industrial Revolution in a revolutionary way. In the three decades after the Second World War, technological change, the pace of technological change and innovation wasn't any slower than now. But we had falling inequality, rising labor share, falling capital share, along with low unemployment rates, stable economies with low frequency of crisis. 1980s, all these changes that I was referring to, welfare state retrenchment, financialization, deregulation in all the markets, including labor markets, took place. Neoliberal policies, if you like, in one package. Along with technological change, the same sort of technological change, here we are with the highest levels of inequality, a big reversal in terms of the trends of the last, the three decades after the Second World War in terms of equalization, a big reversal in this trend, We are back to the levels of inequality of the rates of the years of the Great Depression of the 30s. So this is, I think, remarkable. Technology is our friend. We don't want to do repetitive, boring tasks, for God's sake. Who wants to do that? I would very much like cyborgs doing part of that, nothing against cyborgs, on equal grounds with human beings. I'm a fan of science fiction, by the way. So there will be a time when we will have cyborgs, of course, and hopefully we will give them a life with dignity as well. But I don't want to do too much repetitive work. I'm happy to share, to have my share of repetitive work and do creative work in the rest of my time. The beauty of technological change is, thanks to that, we are working part-time now compared to 19th century. And plus, thanks to the, of course, labor movement and the union movement. Otherwise, it wouldn't have happened. I want to work half of the time I'm working now. And I want to have then time for all the things that she's talking about. Who wants to go after work to a discussion in the neighborhood or at the workplace to decide what to produce or how to organize? Really, I feel completely flat after work. If I work half of the time I'm working, oh, I love my job, I'm very privileged, I know, but it is exhausting. I would like to do other things that are not directly related to my work. I would like to have more time for care. I don't have time for care. I don't care, right? So basically, then we need technology for that. So it's our friend. It all depends on how we are making use of it. We are making very bad use of technology at the moment. Global dimension, we certainly need global governance to have a orchestrated change in the rules of the game. So, again, you and I both belong to a generation that we could barely probably remember a time when capital movement was controlled. For some of the other colleagues here, younger than me, you are born to, you woke up into a world that where capital is free to move in 1 second from one country to another. Well, this wasn't the case back in the 70s. Now, this is again not anything very novel I'm saying. So capital control is an important part of anything we're talking about. We're controlling labor mobility. Britain wants to control the mobility of the European Union citizens who are wishing to move to Britain. So we are very aggressive when it comes to labor mobility, of course, over the world, but even in Europe, this is the direction. Nobody is talking about capital mobility. Well, this is the asymmetry. So labor's bargaining power vis-a-vis capital is not just about the unions. It's about, of course, the rise of the power of finance, but the rise in the area of maneuver of capital vis-a-vis labor. Now, if we can't coordinate that globally, what can we do? Europe is a large area. Europe is doing a lot of business across the European Union member states. We could use Europe as a leverage, as opposed to seeing it as a threat, as most of the British people, both on the left and the right of the spectrum, are saying. We could see Europe as a chance to impose rules, level the playground such that we have space to implement the policies that the planet, the majority of the people need. So yes, capital flight is a threat, but European firms don't have anywhere else to go. European firms have to have their headquarters in Europe. They can't all just relocate to some tax haven. They have to be having their bases. We have to make use of this presence to also have their tax bases in where they are, as opposed to some island in the channels. I know that there are a lot more that we can discuss, but I, in case you would like to have another round of questions, I'll stop my remarks here.
Yeah. There was just one question, maybe you could answer that afterwards, is the finance, the state sector, maybe you referred to that in your...
Yes. Well, okay, I just had one quotation there. That's not, again, mine. the wording says, look after employment, the budget will look after itself. Basically, do policies that guarantee, I have extended that. Okay, this originally belongs to Keynes in a radio program in the 30s. Look after full employment, budget will look after itself. I recently commented on the autumn statement of George Osborne, the Conservative Minister of Finance, Chancellor, as it is called in Britain. I said, look after full employment, equality, care, and ecology, the budget will look after itself. Basically, what I'm saying is deficit finance, if you like, spend, borrow, and spend. That's the least you can do. What I'm saying is tax and spend in social and physical infrastructure. They will generate the good outcomes. The budget will look after itself.
I want to follow up on the first question which came up, is on the growth. Do you see any chance that economists can skip in the future this paradigm that economy needs to grow? To my understanding, as long as this is still in place, we will not be able to live in an ecological way. Why? Because economic growth all the time is linked to growth in resource use and in the increase of emission. That's a fact. We maybe can postpone it into the future by introducing green technology, by maybe shifting a bit here and there. But as long as we are not skipping the wish for economic growth and trying to express it in monetary value and make all of the politics and direct the politicians or the decision-making process to that, there will be no chance. The point is that the problems of the ecology cannot be solved by ecologists. They need to be solved by economists, I believe. So, well, that's not my belief. That's the statement which is quite old already. Thank you.
My issue now is kind of with the answer you gave to the speaker before me about technology instead of labor, because yeah, there has been a technological increase since the Industrial Revolution, but there hasn't been software. Software is only since the 1980s, about when you say that all the policy, and now we have programs working in law firms instead of lawyers, and we have a self-driving industry which is going to substitute the transport industry, at least in the US and probably the next 20 years. So there is certainly a development towards a community maybe where we don't have to work anymore. Not everybody has to work, and if we do, only a few hours a day. And if we do, then in the care sector work, which was your suggestion, which maybe is the least susceptible to technological change, then maybe we should just, there should be another system without the classical conventions of payment, because we can just, as soon as almost everybody is working in care sectors, then there is no need for structural payment anymore, but the state can just subsidize living conditions, and in return everybody works in care for the state, but there's no need for this really structural economic system we have right now. So I think labor being replaced by technology is a new problem because of software, which is really doing amazing and really fast changes. For example, the self-driving industry. And I would like to hear your thoughts on that.
Maybe we wake up in a society where no one has to work anymore. And on the other hand, I read this book of Ashish, and he said, he describes in very detail, you know, where 75% of the Indian population, how hard they work, how they can survive on very meager grounds, you know, based on subsistence farming, etc. Is this a luxury debate? I mean, if we look at the very poor people we have still on the planet, you can hear me? Is this a luxury debate, or would you say that this is also a viable solution also for the South?
Now, let me start with the economists' obsession with growth. First of all, of course, you're overestimating the power of the economists. Economists are just responding to a political environment that needs growth. Why? Growth is required as a means to make inequality more palatable for people. Because when I talk about inequality, and my main point about inequality is not just the rising top percent, but the falling share of labor vis-a-vis capital, I don't mean that workers necessarily are worse off compared to their grandmothers and grandparents. In the next 10 years, we may well be worse off compared to where we are now, but the Great Recession changed this trend. Still, if I look at where we were in 2007 compared to 1950, we are better off in terms of our living standards. Our share has declined dramatically, though, as working people in national income. Now, growth has made this fall in labor share, rising inequality, palatable for us because our standards of living have improved as well. The standards of living of the top has improved a lot more. Now, so this is the inequality bit. So if you're taking away growth, then you need redistribution. Otherwise, inequality will become a very bare truth there for everyone, including the middle classes. In that sense, the politicians need growth. The politicians who are delivering the policies of the likes like Warren Buffett, who says we have been leading a class warfare and we won that. And this class warfare maybe was less visible to us in years of good growth. It becomes more visible if you're not growing, then people will need redistribution, will ask for redistribution. In that sense, I think managing without growth and making that a politically desirable and acceptable solution requires redistribution. So if you are an ecologist, if you want to convince people that we don't need growth, but we need to make things different, you need to also give them security, security about the future, security about housing, education, health, pension, old age care. If I think that these are secure public goods, I would need less desire for, I would have less desire for growth because I will know that my old age care is secure. I don't have to rely on ever increasing pay rates. The lower half of the distribution, if people are struggling to make ends meet, you will have to think about redistribution such that they can be convinced that what they have is enough for a life with dignity that includes a living standard but also voice, participation in social life, political life, cultural life, realization of basic human needs. So basically then, the whole question about how can we manage with no growth, or how can we politically push for an ecological agenda that cares for the limits to growth, we need to talk about redistribution very seriously, otherwise it won't happen. And we need to talk about redistribution at home, but also globally. Coming maybe from here to your question, I appreciate cultural differences and obviously the desirable standard for a life with dignity may be different from one region, from one country, from one community to another. But when I look at rural India, I do think there is so much to achieve there in terms of housing standards, in terms of health, education, transport, mobility, basically. And in that sense, yes, we need a complete big developmentalist push there as well. And this is where I see role for large international global interventions that build on our political powers and mobilizes states internationally. Now, their working conditions have to change. Our working conditions have to change too. And technology, when you were talking about technology, technology and particularly software is a new problem, you said. I don't see software or technological change as a problem. That's an opportunity. However, I also really can't imagine that there will be no manual work. Well, there will be some very repetitive boring, exhausting manual work. We have to think how we share that work. There will be more intellectual work the more technology advances, and there is emotional work, like in care. But, you know, I'm an education worker. It's an industry where technological innovation is pushing for mass production of education, distance learning. I can't learn this through distance. I need human contact. I need small classrooms when I'm learning myself. I still take courses, not in necessarily in economics, but in other subjects. I need human contact. So there is a lot of space for work, some of which is very creative work, some of which is very manual, exhausting work, not necessarily undervalued. We have to be able to value all these work that is socially relevant. I don't think speculation in currency markets is a very socially relevant work. We have to rehabilitate some of these people and deploy in socially relevant sectors. We think of retrain them, and I'm sure we will be all very happy to retrain financial sector workers. But there will be work. Now, how many hours should we be working? This is the question. And of course, from here to tomorrow, in the next decades, this is not going to decrease to 20. I don't see 20 hours of a work week as an unrealistic option in some future, but from 37, targeting 35 and 30 seems like medium-term gradual changes, quite interesting, realistic steps. It's about sharing work, distributing it more equally, distributing pay more equally, making the best use of technology and see where it takes us. But I don't see like there will be no need for work. When I say full employment, I'm not praising some sort of waged life. There's a lot of space for self-employment, of course, independence and other ways of producing. There's a lot of space for agrarian production, so I don't also see everyone living in an urban context, working in services and industries. There is, of course, food production, and if Jun et al. Is right, we need to think about food production a lot more seriously. Who is going to feed China? I repeat his question, coming from a Chinese economist, a progressive economist. We need to think about the working conditions, I think. When I recently watched a movie on Finland, and agricultural workers, well, actually self-employed producers in rural Finland, were at the same time having a piano at home, and the lady was singing tango, and the man was playing the piano, and these are rural workers. So, well, I would think of similar living standards for the rural Indian communities of self-employed peasants. And of course, issues like land reform, probably, if you're thinking of Latin America, I don't know the Indian context well enough, but letting people have the resources that they're working with and make the best of it. But let's think of work differently. Let's talk to people what would be their aspirations, and let's think of some convergence to a decent standard for all.
Okay, this is a good last word, I think. Thank you so much, and sorry, I switched off my mic. Apparently, I can't even handle that technology, so I'm sorry about that. And a last word from my side, I have not said that I don't expect Indian workers to be able, not to be able to handle a piano.
I didn't
think about it, but I don't meant that.
No, I really didn't. No, I didn't. I didn't think this was your point, but I think you can aspire to a very different rural India as well.
Yeah. So thank you for your interesting question, for your interesting remarks. Thank you, Özlem, for your interesting points.
Thank you very much for a very inspiring
and
discussion.
And for coming. Yeah. And so good night.
Thank you.